sure you can have a nice career, a nice whatever. If you have not confronted the wounds of your past, you're still wounded. Yes. You don't have to agree with me, but it's true. So you can say, oh, well, I'm healed. I've gone to God and said, Lord, forgive my dad or my mother. But if you have not confronted those wounds, you're still wounded, whether you like it or not. You've got to go to your past and say, I forgive you. Because it doesn't just liberate them, it liberates yourself so you can have a successful future in God. Not just with God, but with your successful future spouse, your future children, and your future career. If you don't believe me, John 4 says that when Jesus went to the woman and she was, you know, saying, I have no husbands. And Jesus said, yeah, you don't. You had five husbands. And the one you have now is not the one you're supposed to be with. And he said, I forgive you. And she moved on with her life. But the thing is, he confronted her about her scars. He didn't sit back and, like, sit there and say, well, you know, Father in this humanity, you know, forgive him. No, he confronted the wounds. He healed the blind. He laid his hands on the sick. And they were healed because he confronted their wounds. So if you want to be free, truly free in God, you've got to go to your wounds and say, I refuse to be a prisoner of my experiences. I can't be a prisoner of depression, of low self-esteem, of things I shouldn't be a part of. Because if we strive for every man's acceptance, we're left in pain from man's rejection. So we can't get caught up in, you know, things we feel bad about, because it's going to jeopardize our future with God. So anyways, I just thought I'd say that because it's true. You know, we think that confronting our wounds is a sign of insecurity, but really, it's a sign of maturity. You know, if you go to your wounds and say, you know, I forgive you, and don't do anything about it, it's useless. Faith without works is always going to be dead. Right. You got to show faith that the prayers you're praying is actually going to work, and you got to go out and do it. Yes. It makes a difference. So anyways, when I did that, it broke a lot of chains. You know, my dad is still not in church, but I know he'll be back. He'll be at this altar. And, you know, my faith is so high right now, it doesn't even matter right now, because I know he's coming back. Because if he did it for me, he's going to do it for him too. So in January, there was a Maryland DC Youth Workers training, and I went to that. There's a lot of good things they talked about. I was thinking it was Brother Worthington that talked about just, like, practical principles of how to have a set schedule, manage your time, and just have a system that would work. So started applying it, and I was getting ready to graduate this past semester, and I had a lot of challenges. The first one was, of course, gas, and then that was at work. I was like, well, how am I going to be flexible with my schedule, because the classes I took were Mondays and Tuesdays. So I talked to my supervisor. He said, well, you're going to have to find people to cover you every Monday and Tuesday just to go to school. And I sat there, and I thought, well, I'm going to lose more hours. I don't know how all this money's going to come, where this money's going to come from, but I was like, you know what? I've come too far to stop now. I got to finish. So I would find people. I would call every week and say, hey, can you cover my Mondays and my Tuesdays? Every Monday, I would go to work for an hour. I know that sounds so dumb. This is how they work. And then so I would leave at 3 o'clock in Gaithersburg and drive to Towson just to be on time for my 4:20 class. And then Tuesdays, I had no issues. I just drove from home to school. So that was simple. And then on March 23rd, I got back from a nice, needed vacation. I saw a good family of mine. And just got a call about the background check, and I'm like, okay, I hope I get this. And then she called, gave me a conditional offer. She said, all I need to do is pass a psychological exam, and physical exam, duh. What do you know? So I was like, okay, God, we'll see what happens. I didn't want to jump anything. I just wanted to take my time and see what happens. So May 14th, I got the job. It was a week before I graduated. I just want to point this one thing out, though, that's pretty significant. When I came back, really started walking with God in 2013, I was in car wash. I went from a sales associate that same year at the mall to security last year. Now as a 911 operator. And the reason why this is so significant, because when you give your heart, your mind, your soul to God, he will open up doors that you don't even realize where it's going to come from. You can say, well, I don't see nothing here, but hey, I got something right over here for you. And the cool thing about this job is that it starts the week that I went to Ghana last year, where I went from the 13th to the 23rd of June. June 15th is actually when I start my training. And the cool thing is I went to a church called, it was Sukude Bible, that's where we were for the church, for our first service. And we actually helped plant this church a week later. So when you seek first his kingdom, when you decide to say, you know what, finances, all this, you know, school, all this stuff is great, But when you seek first his kingdom, when you decide to say, you know what, I'm going to step out and take a shot. Look, I didn't have to go to this mission trip. I could have made excuses and say, well, you know, my dad's situation, you know, I'm just going to have to call it quits and just say, you know what, it's too much for me. But no, I decided I got to persevere. I got to see what God has for me. I got to do what God is telling me to do. There's going to be storms. There's going to be problems. There's going to be overwhelming circumstances that might feel like you can't do it, but you can do it because all things are possible through him. It doesn't matter what's around you. You can actually do it. So anyways, during this time, after I graduated, on May 20th, that was the same night I actually accepted the job, I started my own spoken word ministry called Faye. The meaning of it is Freedom After Exodus. It's a YouTube page that I use for spoken word, and we're going to be doing some teaching videos and some book recommendation videos down the road. It's mainly just an outreach endeavor. I figured that I need to share my gifts and get out of my box and not be worried about, you know, what people think about me or what people are going to say, because I got to do something what God has told me to do, not what the person to the right or to the left of me says. I got to do this for me. So the guy in the back, where is he? This guy right here, Manny Samaron, he's my camera guy. Él es hermano menor que nunca tuve. What I said, he's a little brother I never had. So, yeah, he's the man. So anyways, I just did that because I felt so strongly about it, so convicted to just do something for his kingdom. I can't sit back and just wait for opportunities to come by. I can't sit back and say, well, maybe I'll share a sermon or maybe I'll preach. No, I just got to do it for myself, because as long as I'm consistent in my character, my convictions, and my integrity, I'm good to go. You know, everybody, as long as my mom approves of what I do, my pastors approve of what I do, and the friends who I consider my brothers approve, everything else doesn't matter to me. So anyways, I'm going to share a short snippet of a poem we actually just shot in, where did we shoot that, Manny? The piece, it was outside. It was in Gaithersburg. I don't remember where, it was by my house. But anyways, it was by a lake. So the name of this piece is called Skeletons in My Closet. And basically the meaning of it is about, like, you know, we keep a lot of our testimony hidden because we're ashamed of our past. You know, I alluded to earlier about, you know, confronting your past and dealing with the wounds. But some of us, the reason why we can't share our testimony is because we're so ashamed of who we used to be. And we can only overcome this word by the word of our testimony. And the more we share our testimony, the more we liberate people around us, the more they feel inspired, the more we liberate ourselves to keep moving forward in God. So anyways, I'm going to share it, and I'm going to get off the stage and let my next friend go. Hello, how are you? My name is Jason. I grew up in homeschool education where elementary school children view me as dumb, incompetent of learning in public schools, socially outdated, and say when I go to college, I would never make it. At 13, I began to grow overwhelming feelings of insecurities while sinking into the waters of low self-esteem. At 16, my fears of ever surmounting to anything after my high school year seemed to always defeat me. I tried to hide these things back in 2009 when I came back to COC, but those old skeletons crept up at age 20, where I was indulging myself with sexual immorality, worshiping at the altar of pornography. My innocence was stripped from me as I spent time with lust under the bedsheets. Chains of depression were weighing down heavily upon me. And I started to believe that my future would be a life full of insanity. The idea of reestablishing a relationship with God was just another fairy tale instead of an actual reality. And all these experiences never made any sense to me. But in 2013, I decided to rediscover who God called me to be. My whole life would change that summer when I went down to Miami for my first trip in AYC. Came back home from that trip where I found a pen and a piece of paper, started writing down thoughts that eventually manifested into rhymes of poetry. In 2014, I launched a campus ministry, went on another AYC trip to Ghana where I witnessed true worship that changed me completely. And I even brought home a few dashikis. Fast forward to 2015, I graduated from Towson University with a bachelor's degree in psychology. Got a new job as a 911 operator for Montgomery County, where it provides me with financial stability and career growth opportunities. Using YouTube as a device to preach about the authenticity of my testimony and be in awe of how God is transforming my scars into something heavenly. Thank you.
Amen. There's this one time in between May 13th and May 16th that I was confused about. I'm just kidding. Excellent job, Jason, and what a testimony of God's grace and power in your life. Amen. Amen. And can you stand one more time? Can you do that one more time? Amen. We got one more young man to come and share his heart with us tonight. Hallelujah. You know him as Sanjeev. No, you don't know him as that. You know him as Sonny. And Sonny has just stepped into our hearts and have become close to us as we've become close to him. And God has done a mighty work in his life. And we're just thrilled and want him to come and share his heart with us tonight for. Amen.
Amen. Can we give God praise, please? Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, God. Your word is Jesus. You are worthy of every praise, Father. Hallelujah, Jesus, you are worthy, God. Hallelujah, 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 Jesus. In Jesus' name, you may be seated. As Pastor Sean said, my name is Sonny, originally Sanjeev, but most know me as Sonny. I enjoy both those names, though I secretly favor my original name. You may call me by whichever you choose. I came to CLC in June of 2014, so 1 year ago. Everyone here has welcomed me in a very warm way, so I want to say thank you to all of you who I've met, and to those whom I haven't, I look forward to meeting you. Pastor Sean asked me to speak today to testify. Pastor Sean, thank you. I know I'm here today as a result of direction from God. So with you, I want to go back to when my walk with Jesus began. I was raised in a Catholic household. I learned the traditions and rituals and prayers. All my life, I lived the life of a good Catholic boy. I was openly obedient to my parents and respectful to all my elders. As far as the rest of the world could tell, I was an angel fallen from heaven. But I had secret sins. As a child, it was as simple as annoying my older sister. But as I grew, that gradually morphed. My secret sins grew darker, so I needed to hide more when I did them. I continued on the life of a good religious Catholic boy. Finally, I turned 18 and I went to college. It was here that I looked around at the world and I questioned everything. Why do I live this way? Must I do it to please everyone at church? But I'm at college. No one is here to see. What about all these kids here? They look so happy doing what they're doing, drinking, smoking, partying, etc. My whole life, everyone has been happy about the way I've lived. The good kid. But have I honestly been happy about it? It was then at that moment I decided to turn away from God. That spring semester of my freshman year at Virginia Commonwealth University, I joined a fraternity. That summer, I broke up with a girl I had been dating for 2.5 years. She was not in school with me, but was back in Maryland. This breakup put me into a depression. I was lost, confused, depressed. So I thought, why not do something I've never done? Why not try something new? It was this summer, the summer of 2010, that I tried weed for the first time. I was instantly hooked. The whole sensation, it mesmerized me. I kept doing it. I went into my sophomore year. At this point, my parents were separated. They were deciding whether to divorce or not. I didn't have this girlfriend that was with me for, at the time, was a very long time. And at this point, I smoked pot. I felt I deserved to have fun, unrestrained fun. Suffice to say, I went a little lower down the drain, down the swirl around the drain. By the end of my spring semester, I had smoked and drank enough to the point that school didn't matter to me much. I walked away that spring semester, with a 0.0 GPA. Two of the classes I dropped, and two of the classes I failed. I dropped them because I failed them. My mom spoke with me about coming back home to the community college, Montgomery College. I mean, she was helpless, I was helpless. What was she gonna say? I mean, how much can you yell at a kid who just flunked? How much more could you break me, honestly? So when she told me to come to community college, I resisted. I was stubborn, I was proud. I was this close to signing up with the National Guard. The Army National Guard Reserve, so they could help me pay the $37,000 it cost me per year to attend this out-of-state university. By the grace of God, I was convinced at the end of that summer to stay in Maryland to attend Montgomery College with the intent to transfer into University of Maryland. I stayed at MC for 2 years, and in those 2 years, I got together with the ex-girlfriend again that I mentioned earlier. We dated for another 6 months and broke up. And then I hit another rock bottom. It was here that I really realized the state I was in. I realized how big of a pit I had dug myself. I turned 21 later after that. And even after I was 21, I decided to go to the bars. I came home at 4 or 5 in the morning sometimes after having drunk a lot. There was this one night that I went to a party in College Park, and we were drinking, and one of my friends said, "Hey, are you ready to go?" I said, "Yeah, sure. Let me just take this shot first." I did, and then I drove. And the whole time I drove, I was fine. You know, I drove from College Park to Silver Spring, fully conscious. Everything was fine. I drove straight. We got to Silver Spring, to his house. I dropped him off. He said, "Are you okay to drive?" I said, yeah, I'm fine. And I left his house, and I remember about 5 to 10 minutes after that. And after that, I blacked out. I woke up at maybe 4:30 or 5 o'clock in the morning. I was in my car still in the driver's seat. It was reclined back. I opened my eyes, and I was deathly afraid. I got up. I looked around to see where I was. I was in front of my sister's apartment. Doors were locked. Keys weren't in the ignition. I didn't know where they were. I was looking for them everywhere, under the seats, on the sides, nowhere. I found my phone finally. I called my friend who I dropped off at Silver Spring. It was 4 a.m. He woke up and he was like, "What are you talking about? Like, what do you mean? What's going on?" And I said, "Dude, I don't know what I just did. I don't know exactly where I am. I don't know what happened. I don't know if I hit somebody or anything." And I was really helpless. And I found my keys. I got outside of the car, and I just walked around the car just to inspect it, just to see if any damage was there, if there was any blood there. And it was surreal. There was nothing. Nothing. No, not a scratch. Nothing. And I couldn't explain it, but I walked away from it, and it didn't get better. I kept drinking, kept going to the bars. I didn't drink as much, but I still drove. At some point during that time, I truly realized I'm in a pit, and I'm trying to make my life better. I'm trying to be happy. I'm trying to do better, but I keep failing. And The way I pictured it was, if you imagine a well that's just dry, right? There's nothing in it, no water, but just the floor at the bottom. I felt like I was in that, at the very bottom. And I was praying to God at this point, and I said, God, please, 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 please reach down with your hand and pull me up. Because I can't get out. And nobody around me could understand. They couldn't reach me. It's like they were standing around the well looking in and saying, Sonny, I'm trying. But they couldn't do anything. They didn't have any power. And I prayed, God, please. And this was spring of 2012. And that summer, a friend invited me to this conference in Houston. And this Baptist preacher was preaching. And all I knew was I needed God. So I went to this thing, and he began preaching on the identity of God. Who is God? The portrait of God. Now for a moment, pardon me, we're going to excuse the oneness. He didn't go into that. But it was, the theme of the whole thing was the portrait of God. So he went through the scripture describing what the Bible says about who God is. And I remember this one day, it was a 4 or 5 day conference. And this one day he preached on Isaiah 6, and the where Isaiah sees into the throne room of God. And when Isaiah looks into the throne room, he sees the train of God filling the entire temple. Now in my mind, we were in a room kind of like this. It was really big. And so I thought, man, what would it be like for the train of God to fill this whole room? You know, and then Isaiah sees these two angels with 6 wings each, 2 to cover their face because they couldn't even look upon the glory of God. It was so great. 2 to cover their feet, he said, to cover their creatureness, and 2 to fly. And they said one to another, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God of all the hosts. All of heaven and earth is filled with his glory. When the preacher said it, he yelled it into the microphone, which I'm not going to do to you. He yelled it into the microphone, and everybody in the room who was dozing woke up.
Maybe you better do that yelling right now.
Amen. Should I? I thought about it. They yelled praise of God. The whole room shook, and smoke was coming up. And I thought to myself, what church have I ever been to that people praise like that? If the angels who are higher than men praise God with such vigor, such force, why don't we? God stuck, pricked me with curiosity, with hunger. Scripture says, blessed are the hungry.
That's right.
Forgive me, I don't know how to finish it. But what I know is the blessing comes with the hunger. And God stuck this hunger in me, and he said, come find out who I am, because where you were for 18 years, 19 years, 20 years, 21 years, they didn't teach you who I was. But you come find out who I am. When I came home, all I knew was I had to join a Bible teaching church. That's all I knew. I knew nothing about denominations. So I came home, I was talking to one of my friends. I told him about this incredible experience I had, and he said, I know of a great church that you can join. It's incredible. You can feel the presence of God there. He said, Church of the Redeemer. It's an amazing church. I said, let's go. Sunday came, and I decided it's too early in the morning. I'm not going to go. He told me on Saturday night. So a week goes by. Saturday night comes again, and I have this. At the point, I'm sorry, I was working at Red Lobster, so I was a waiter. And this friend of mine was also a waiter. And so Saturday night, I'm working at Red Lobster, and I have this table. This woman comes in with these 2 young girls. Her name was Jennifer. And we got along very well. We clicked, we talked, we connected, you know, and somehow we got talking about church. And she said, oh, I know this amazing church, and we're about to go to service at 6:30 Saturday night. I said, oh, really, what church is it? She said, Church of the Redeemer. Okay. That happened in 1 week. And so I said, maybe God's trying to tell me something. So I said, Sunday morning, I'm going. Sunday morning comes. I wake up at 9:45. Service starts at 10. I have work at 11. So I'm like, nah, I'm not going to go. The next week comes. I wake up at 9:30. And all I knew was, I need to go to church. I went. I had an experience. It wasn't nearly as powerful as this, but I knew that God wanted me there, so I went there. I stayed there for a year and a half. It was there that Jesus taught me how to read the Bible. He taught me how to pray over my Bible. He taught me how to seek after him in his word, and I felt like I really got to know him, you know? And I stayed there, and after a year and a half, I felt, you know, when I first started there, if you're looking at this as a graph, you know, for you, if you're looking at this graph, I felt like when I started, I was growing exponentially. And over time, it just started to plateau a little bit more. And I was still growing, but it was so incremental that I couldn't even notice, and I felt like I wasn't. I graduated with my associates from Montgomery College, and I was still going to Church of the Redeemer, and I finally got into the University of Maryland, which is where I wanted to transfer. When I got into the University of Maryland, I knew so deep down that I was there because God wanted me there. And so I knew I had to find a campus ministry to go to. So I found a campus ministry, I looked for this campus ministry called Crew. Crew's connected with Church of the Redeemer, so I thought, oh, that would be good for me. I looked everywhere for them. I went to the student organization fair. I contacted them online. I found someone, one of my friends had a number of a member of their campus ministry. I texted him, and I got zero replies. And I said, okay, God, you want me to come to University of Maryland? I know that. You want me to join a campus ministry? I know that. So where do you want me to go? And I happened upon this apostolic campus ministry. And I thought, you know, I got to go somewhere. So I'll go to this one. I came, and I felt something. I didn't know how to describe it. Can't say I felt tingles, but the first night, they didn't have service. They had prayer. And I had walked in right after they had just finished, like, interceding. You know, there was travail and all that stuff. And I walked in right when they finished, so I didn't hear a peep. When I walked in, everybody was in a circle talking to each other. So I come down, and I meet everybody. You know, I met Ben. And we talked a little bit, and then Mike, who was leading, he said, you know, we're not having service, we're just praying together. We're going to pray one more time, and then we're going to go home. Do you want to stay? I said, yeah, why not? I could do with some prayer. He said, okay, cool. So the guys go off to one side, the girls go off to another, and that stuck out to me because the church that I was coming from, guys and girls were together. So I said, okay, that's fine. So we stood in a circle, and it was me, it was Mike, Ben, and Ty, I believe. We stood in a circle, we put our hands up on each other's shoulders. Now, the way I was taught to pray was, I start, we go around in a circle, and then you finish. You close. Yeah. Yeah. So I put my hands up on their shoulders, you know. They said, okay, we're going to pray. All right. They began. We began to pray. And 1, 2, 3, they were all speaking tongues. The group of girls, they were all speaking in tongues, and it was loud. It wasn't just something soft and gentle. They were going. And I have my hands up on each of them, and my eyes are closed, and I'm just thinking to myself, Jesus, where have you brought me? I know he led me. I felt that. But this is crazy. But I knew, because God had been leading me in the word. You know, I knew that tongues was in the Bible. So I said, you know what? Tongues is in the Bible, so I'm not going to toss that out. It's a little on the extreme end, but I'll deal with it. You know, like, we can talk about it. So I stayed. And after we prayed, okay, everybody was like, all right, we just start talking, you know, fellowshipping and everything. And then me and Ben started talking, and we probably ended around like 8 o'clock or so, right? Prayer, maybe. And when me and Ben started talking, we just started witnessing to each other. Like, I told him about my story. He told me about his story. And we ended up talking for 3 hours straight. We left around like 11:30 or 12, you know? And I thought, man, that was an experience. You know, that was, wow. And I just knew I had to come back. So I came back, and this was my stipulation. As long as this campus ministry lines up with the Word of God, that's all I had. You know, you got all these churches, sorry, I don't want to bash anybody, but you got all these churches, and they all have these different doctrines. They're all teaching different things, but the Bible talks about unity. So all I had to rely on was the Word. If it lines up with the Word, I'm here. If it doesn't, we'll talk about it, and if you don't budge, I'm out. And so I came back next week. I came back next week, and there was a service. This time, it was Brother Whittington from Antioch. And I think he's one of the leaders for campus ministries. And he preached, and he preached on... Okay, sorry. I'll close up soon.
That's Brother Kleindienst's mic. Don't take too much of his time.
These things are timed? Okay, so Brother Whittington starts preaching on the importance of the Word of God, how you have to consume it every day, and I was just like, oh, wow, like, he doesn't know my thoughts, so if he's speaking that, there's no coincidences, right? So that has to be God. So I came back, and I came back, and I came back. I started doing a Bible study on the Holy Ghost, receiving the Holy Ghost, and speaking in tongues, and for some reason, I was just on the fence, you know, like, felt like there was this fence, you know, and I'm just on it, and here's some water, and I just... But I didn't want to jump in. It was scary. I was afraid. I felt so much fear, so much confusion. But we just kept doing Bible studies. And there was one day that I walked in and told you about how I was dealing with depression. And the depression was setting in. And it was so heavy this day. I went through the whole day Wednesday. I had class from 11 to 6:30 in the evening. And the last class was my longest class. It went from 4:30 to 6:30. It was a discussion-based class, 22 people in this classroom with one moderator, the professor. We went through all 2 hours of it discussing all kinds of things. All 21 of the people in the class said something. But my mind was just so messed up, so coiled, so confused, so depressed, so defeated, I couldn't form a thought. So 2 hours go by, and I'm the only one that hasn't said a word, hasn't cracked a smile, nothing. And I was just looking at the clock thinking, God, let 7 p.m. roll around so I can go to campus ministry and I can just worship you. When I walked in, we started praying, worshiping, you know, and Mike started talking into the microphone, and he said, you know, some of you have a weight on your shoulders. You need to surrender. We're in a classroom. I sat down at the desk. I put my hands flat out on the desk, and I just said, Lord, if you're going to do anything, do it now. I'm done. Ben came over, prayed with me. Ty, another brother at the campus ministry, came around. Mike came around. They started praying with me. And in my mind, I'm thinking, is this it? Is it going to happen now? Am I going to receive the Holy Ghost now? And they just kept praying with me. He said, surrender everything, surrender everything. So I started naming things. I surrendered my future, my school, my family, my friends, my everything, my life, everything, God, everything, everything. Anything that came to my mind, I said it. And there was this thought that just popped into my head. It said, what if all these people have formed this group, you know, and they do all this crazy stuff just so that they can get other people to do it? To make you look like a fool so that later they can just laugh at you. We got one. And I felt God say to me, you need to surrender your self-consciousness. I said, Lord, I surrender my self-consciousness to you. At that moment, Mike said, begin praising him. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus, hallelujah, Jesus, hallelujah, Jesus, hallelujah. Say his name, Jesus, 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 Jesus. Hallelujah, 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 Jesus. Ila boraya karayanda la bosha yata rayele borayanda la bosha yere boraya taye. Ita shayata la borayanda la bosha yele boraya taye. Oh, Jesus. Jesus. Jesus! Take 2 more minutes, all right? 2 more minutes. I prayed in tongues with Ben, with Ty, with Mike, and there were other people around us, you know, praying. We prayed for tongues, just standing there, eyes closed, heads lifted to heaven, praying in tongues for 45 minutes to an hour, just straight. And by the time I was finished, it felt like it just went by like that. When I opened my eyes, I didn't move, you know, like I didn't fall out, I didn't faint, nothing. It was so gentle. From the outside, I looked like a mess, but from the inside, I just felt peace. Just peace. And they looked at me, you know, and they were just smiling. Congratulations. Congratulations, congratulations, you received the Holy Ghost. And I looked at Mike and I said, is that it? He said, yeah. I didn't realize exactly what had happened until I took my first step. And I told you I was dealing with depression. Now, I don't know if you guys know anything about calisthenics. You know, it's body weight workouts. There's this thing that people who do calisthenics, they have these chains, all right? The links are like about this thick, you know, like the size of my fist. And they just interlink. And these guys, they hang it around their shoulders, you know? And then they do like all these kinds of exercises, like pull-ups or whatever. I felt when I took my first step that I had been walking around with those chains. And after we had prayed, I received the Holy Ghost. Those chains were just there. They were just there. I knew that I would never have to put those on again. Not ever. Not ever. Because depression has no place. Anxiety has no place. Fear has no place. Confusion has no place. At the name of Jesus, it all has to run. It all has to run. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Come on, let's worship the Lord for a moment. There's freedom in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. We love you, Lord God. Hallelujah. Isn't the Lord good? Hallelujah. And I'm so thankful for Sonny and Jason and these fine young men, hallelujah, that have given their life to God and chosen to walk a path that's pleasing to Him. Let's give the Lord one more hand praise and thanksgiving.
Hallelujah. I give you glory.
Jacob.
Something about the presence of the Lord. There's freedom and there's liberty in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Make your way back to your seats. Great. Hallelujah. The Lord is certainly good to us. We've had a great day. Hallelujah. Wonderful. Wonderful presence of the Lord. Amen. Let's stand. We're going to move right into our main. There's a few minutes left on this microphone battery. Hallelujah. We have to get this. Put another quarter in here pretty soon. If we're not careful. Amen. Hallelujah. It's good to have my brother-in-law and sister-in-law, Brother Mike and Kenny Ginger. They're right over here. Amen. With Evangeline, their daughter. Naomi, their daughter. Valor, their son, and Elias, their son. Hallelujah. They just have launched their home missions work in Houma, Louisiana. And they actually, when they started, they had a built-in Sunday school already. They have four kids. They've got the nursery covered, and then they have a couple of the grades covered up there. They're up here traveling through and stop for the weekend, and we're certainly privileged and honored to. Mike, come up here and just give us a, just say hello to everybody. Come on up here, just say hello. I say, Mike, it's actually Pastor Kenny.
Praise God. I'm so glad to be in this house, so glad. The power of God's here. The anointing of God's here. This is a powerful church, and there's great things going to happen in this city. I want you to know, I feel the presence of God in this place. We got to be thankful for a church like this church. Praise God. Hallelujah. God bless you. We give you.
Amen. Love you, man. Amen. We had a great time this morning, did we not? Did Brother Klein Dentz deliver the word of the Lord this morning? Were you blessed this morning by the word of the Lord? Let's lift our hands and ask God to touch us as he comes right now to deliver what God has given him. In Jesus' name, we thank you, Lord God, for your grace and mercy. We ask, Lord Jesus, that the word would be delivered to our hearts, that we would be receptors of the word, that it would be planted inside of us. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody say amen.
Thank you, Pastor, and praise the Lord, everybody. Isn't it great to be in church on Sunday night? Sunday night alive, amen. Certainly been our honor to be here. We've been here since the prayer conference, the Northeast Regional Prayer Conference with the World Network of Prayer, Thursday and Friday, and pretty much in church all day, every day, and then again today, and I'm enjoying myself, and it's been our honor and privilege to be here, both my wife and I, to be with you in this magnificent church. Very special honor tonight to have my wife's little brother, that's the big guy standing right behind her there, Pastor Ray Windsor. Amen. God bless him. Coming, some men with him. And love him so much. He's doing a great work in pastoring a church. And there's a great atmosphere in this room tonight. And I talked to you this morning about being led of the Spirit, especially in your conscience, or that your conscience is bathed, your innermost being is bathed by the Holy Spirit of God. Allowing you to make intuitive decisions that are led by the Holy Spirit of God. Tonight, just for a few minutes, I want to speak some victory into your life. We talked a lot at the prayer conference about the challenges we're facing right now in the world, the evil that is rampant, the violence that is everywhere, all the bloodshed, all the addictions and problems. But tonight, from the Word of God, there is tremendous amounts of victory. And I'm just going to declare and prophesy and preach victory into your spirit till you start feeling good about how great God is in your life. Two verses of Scripture, 2 Corinthians 2:14 and 1 Corinthians 15:57. 2 Corinthians 2:14 and 1 Corinthians 15:57. We'll start with 2 Corinthians. I do want to say, my wife and I have been treated so wonderfully by Pastor and Sister Libby, who is volunteering tonight with the deaf and the blind. And we've been eating well, wonderful hotel room, lots of great fellowship and fun. And I'd also like to compliment this wonderful, beautiful facility that you have built by faith and by labor and by giving to the glory of God. And this journey's only just begun for us here. And it's going to get better and better and better. And who knows what all the Lord has. But I believe it was the will of God. And He has moved you to this place to protect and preserve. And you're going to grow and there's going to be great revival. And if you believe that, say amen. 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Oh, let me mention, I've just launched a book. I don't have any with me because I just sold them all at a conference I was at. But you can download it online. It's called The Secret of a Bounce. It's just how to kind of bounce back from the unfortunate circumstances that happen in life. If you go to bouncesecrets.com, you can download that book. It's like $7 or something like that. 2 Corinthians chapter 2. If you found it, say amen. Praise the Lord. Now thanks be to God, which always, say always, causes us to triumph in Christ and makes manifest the savor of His knowledge by us in every, say every, place. 1 Corinthians 15:57. Thanks be to God who giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Would you clap your hands unto the Lord for any victory you've ever experienced and for faith in a victory that is yet to come? Blessed be the name of the Lord. Would you worship His name while you clap unto His glory? Let a hallelujah out. Let a praise the Lord out. Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me I will bless Your holy name with a loud voice. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Woo! That makes an atmosphere feel good. You may be seated in the name of the Lord. God bless you tonight. I am thrilled to hear the stories of both of these young men that came up here and told us about their lives and how it was and how the Lord turned things around. You have heard two victory stories tonight. Stories of victory. How that God can move into depression and God can move into substance abuse and every other kind of thing of life and turn it around. And it should help you understand, no matter where you are or what you're going through or what's happening in your life, God can come in and turn things around for you as well. He's a turnaround God. He's a picker-upper God. He's the one that reaches down into the miry clay and picks you up and puts your feet on the rock to stay. He's the one that brings light into our darkness. He's the one that brings understanding into our confusion. He's the one that makes a way where there is no way and opens a door where there is no door. And can find young men like these two and many others around here. When nobody else was paying attention, God knew where they were. God saw what they were going through. And God in His unique way knew how to reach down and bring them right where they belong. Hallelujah. How many's glad the Lord found you where you were in your situation, in your circumstance? We didn't know where you were, but God did. You're a victory in progress tonight. That's the prophetic word I want to speak into your life. You're a victory in progress. Progress, regardless of the circumstances at the moment, Let God keep working on it a little while. Let God's hand keep working in your situation a little while. You'll find out He always causes us to triumph. He has a way of working things out. You're a victory in progress. That's a VIP. Kind of got this VIP thing on my mind. I was telling Pastor Libby a day at lunch. I got off the airplane the other day in Atlanta, just last week in Atlanta, and I had a close connection. And as I come off the airplane, told you today I'm a diamond medallion million miler, and there stands a guy with an iPad with my name on it. And I didn't know if that was good news or bad news, but I walked up to him and said, "Well, I'm Doug Kleindienst." He was right outside the door, didn't even get up the jetway. He said, "I'm here to give you VIP service." I said, "Wonderful, which way do we go?" Went out the door, down the steps. They had a Porsche waiting there, a Porsche SUV. He put my bags in the back, put me in the Porsche SUV, drove me to the other side of the airport, up the steps. We got up the steps. He said, "Right there's your gate." I felt like a VIP. If their goal was to make me feel important, it worked. I was feeling pretty good when I walked in there after being escorted around the airport in a Porsche. Let me tell you something. God's going to bring some victory into your life. You're a V. I hope I can make you feel like a VIP here tonight before I get done preaching. You are a victory in progress. You might be in the valley, but you're on your way through the valley. You might be in the darkness, but you're coming out of the darkness. You might be in the storm, but God's going to give you peace in the storm. Can anybody receive the prophetic word from the Lord and say amen? Now, you know, here in the Pentecostal church, we get a little loud. And during preaching, we say amen and hallelujah and thank you, Jesus. And back in the old church, we ran around, did all kinds of crazy stuff. We're way toned down these days. Who knows what might happen? But the reason we say amen is amen means so be it. And when a good word is spoken from the Bible or a good prophetic word is put out into the atmosphere and you say amen, you're snatching it out of the atmosphere and saying, "So be it for me." And you know, some of these folks aren't happy just to say amen. They get their hands up because they want to catch it as it's going by. Some of them get both hands up. I want double that right there. If there's anybody going to be a victory in progress, I'm volunteering. Looks like we have a lot of volunteers here tonight. Choose me, Lord. If you're looking for somebody to bring out, let me be next. I'm ready to come through. I'm ready to come out. The scripture is powerful, and it presents an incredible impartation. But I want to remind you tonight that this verse I'm bringing to you is not out of a self-help book or a feel-good book. It's right out of the holy book. It is a divinely inspired truth. The Bible is not God's word or man's word about God. It is God's word to man. Very important to understand that the thoughts originate in God's mind. The ideas originate from God's spirit, and they are imparted to us. When the Bible says He giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ, that is the divinely inspired breath of God for our victory. When it says He always causes us to triumph in every place, that is a divinely inspired truth from the essence and the spirit of the Almighty God. It's easy to miss it because it's so simple, but it is a profound release of victory into our lives. It's easy to miss it because it is seemingly in apparent contradiction to the circumstances of our life. Well, I'm glad victory's coming because it's sure not here right now. We read these verses sometimes in the Bible and we know they're true, but we're not experiencing the truth of them at the moment. But be ye well assured that your circumstances and mine do not negate the truth of the word of God. So let's just dwell on it for a minute. Let's just let our minds soak it in. Thanks be to God. We'll come back to that. Who always, that word means continually, eternally, repeatedly, and constantly. Causes means He activates, originates, and produces triumph, victory, success, conquest, with the joy associated with victory. So here are some ways to soak it into your spirit. Thanks be to God who continually activates our victory. Thanks be to God who repeatedly produces our success. Thanks be to God who is the eternal source of our joy. No wonder the verse begins, thanks be to God, because through him I can do all things. Through him I can come out of all this darkness. I can come out of all this trouble. I can come through this confusion. Does anybody just feel like shaking off those heavy bands? Is there a thanks be to God in your heart somewhere tonight that says, I'm not always going to be sad. I'm not always going to be discouraged. I'm not always going to be in this trial. I'm going to shake this thing off. There's a better me. There's a God-powered me. There's a God-anointed me. There's a me filled with the glory and the power and the joy of God. Somebody ought to let a hallelujah go up and say, thanks be to God. He's going to move me into victory. He's going to carry me from where I am to where I need to be. We used to sing victory in Jesus, our Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He paid the price for my sanity. He paid the price for my sound mind. He paid the price that I could have healthy emotions. He paid the price that I don't have to go crazy. He paid the price I don't have to run my truck off a bridge. He paid the price I don't have to put a gun to my head. He paid the price I don't have to take a bunch of sleeping pills. He paid the price that I don't have to live unhappy and miserable and distraught and on the edge of a nervous breakdown. I can walk into the house of God. The songs can lift up his praise. The word of God can bring joy into my heart. I can let a hallelujah out and begin to feel the victory till we're singing like we used to sing. Victory, victory shall be mine. Victory, victory shall be mine. If I hold my peace and let the Lord fight my battles, victory, victory shall be mine. I'm gonna preach victory. I'm gonna quote scriptures. I'm gonna prophesy to you tonight until you begin to feel it from the top of your head to the sole of your feet, till it flows out of you like a river of living water. If God be for us, if he's on my side, said if he's on my side, what if God is for you? I got a fella put on Twitter the other day, the scripture, if God be for us, who can be against us? I was feeling a little ornery and a little anointed all at the same time. I quoted it with a hashtag. I said, if God be for us, who cares who's against us? If God is on my side, if I have done anything to find favor with God, if I have done anything that pleased the Lord, if my repentance has been accepted, if the sacrifice of my praise has been received in glory, if God is favoring me and God is on my side. The devil's mad and I'm glad and I know what it takes to defeat him. Get a smile on my face. Get some word of God in my heart. Sing me a song of glory and say, I'm coming on through. I'm coming on out. You know what I feel like tonight? Let God arise and his enemies be scattered. Let God arise in your heart. Let God arise in your praise. Let God arise in your faith. And let the enemies of God be scattered. Woo! In the name of Jesus, I break the bondage of depression. In the name of Jesus, I cast out every spirit of oppression, every spirit of suicide, every feeling of despair, every feeling of hopelessness, every feeling of being trapped or bound or restricted. I declare by prophetic unction, I release you in the name of Jesus into the joy of the Lord. Let God arise in your heart right now. Why don't you let God arise like this young man showed us tonight? Let God swell up in your spirit till it flows out of the abundance of your heart of praise. You just cannot hold back. If you've never done it in church, why don't you just clap your hands? Ain't nobody watching you. Ain't nobody watching you. Just clap your hands and give the Lord some praise. While everybody else is making noise, why don't you just let a hallelujah out and see what would happen to your spirit? Make a joyful noise, all ye people. Shout unto God with the voice of triumph. He wants you to express victory and express triumph. Let it flow out of you until it floods everything else out. All right, we'll continue the Bible study. You can be seated. Psalm 60 and 12 says, through God we shall do valiantly, for it is he who shall tread down our enemies. Let me help you be happy about something tonight. You know, we used to talk about that back in the old church. We'd say, oh, didn't Sister So-and-so get happy tonight? Man, Brother So-and-so, he really got happy. That just says you don't have to come happy. You can get happy when you get here. And you're supposed to get happy when you come to church. We sing another song. This happy face that I'm a-wearing, Jesus put it there to stay. The world didn't give it to me. And the world can't take it away. I wish you'd just smile to make the devil mad. Just get a happy face and say, this happy face, only the Lord can give me this happy face. My job didn't give it to me. My money didn't give it to me. My stuff didn't give it to me. Life didn't give it to me. But the Lord came down and put joy unspeakable and full of glory in my heart. Woo! Hey, I'd like to see God turn that smile into some holy laughter before we get out of here. I never preached on holy laughter. I don't know if I believe in it or not, but I think we need some of it right here tonight. I've decided right now we need some holy laughter. Amen. Say, well, you're getting way off the deep end now. Well, I think we need to get off the deep end a little here for a minute. The world is suffocating us with negativism. They are suffocating us with bad news. They are suffocating us in trying to cram everything down our throat that is vile and unholy and evil and ungodly. What, you just let tonight something swell up inside of you and let God put some laughter in your soul that doesn't come from any source, but the holiness of his spirit, the righteousness of his character, the goodness of his grace. You ought to be able to laugh. You ought to have some joy. He paid the price through the death, the burial, and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. He broke these bondages. He broke these chains. He set me free. He set me free. See if you can feel a little bit of it. Reach out there and see if you can feel a little freedom. I'm about to feel the funky chicken coming on here. About to do the twirly bird. Come on, we're a Pentecostal church. Don't you think it's about time we act like it a little bit around here? Ain't nobody even afraid yet. You ain't having church till somebody gets nervous around you somewhere. I like to watch those old-time church mothers power of God get on them, and they'd be doing something like this. Like they just don't know what to do with it. When's the last time you had so much God on you, you just didn't even know which way to go? Trying to praise God all sophisticated. Got too much God on you, can't even figure out what to do with it. Would you tilt your head back and just shout a praise? Get yourself a little loose. You tilted your head back and just said, "Woo! I feel good." And it's not alcohol, it's not drugs, it's not cigarettes, it's nothing immoral, it's not ungodly. I feel good because he's all over me and he's keeping me alive. I said he's all over me and he's keeping me alive. Woo! Hey, you can have victory if you want it. We got one good thing about living in America, at least for now. We can have church as long as we want to have, and we can have as much church as we want to have. And while we're here, we can get as excited as we want to get. Ain't nobody stopping anybody here right now. If you want to worship God, worship him. If you want to feel God, feel him. If you want to cry out, cry out. If you want to break through, break through. If you need anointing, get anointing. Can you play that organ? Woo! I release you. Well, Jesus on the inside, working on the outside. Oh, what a change in my life. Anybody come to get happy? Now let me give you something to get happy about. Now, I got plenty to be happy about because he brought me out of the miry clay. He brought me out of the darkness. He saved me. I've already been to the water. And I've already been baptized. And I've already been converted. So I'm feeling all right. So our names are written down. I remember when I was 12 years old and I came up out of the baptistry waters. And the old church got to singing. There's a new name written down in glory. And it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. The white-robed angels tell the story. A sinner has come home. So I got a good reason to be happy. Because if I wasn't in the church tonight, I'd probably be dead. I'd probably be in jail. I'd probably be addicted. I'd probably be a drunk or a drug addict. Probably done hurt somebody. But he saved me from all of that. He set me free from all of that. He wrote my name down in the Lamb's Book of Life. And when Antichrist comes to get this world, Jesus is coming to get my soul. I'm in this world, but not of this world. You got a well inside of you. I said you got a well inside of you, and it wants to spring up, and it wants to fill your soul with joy. But here we go. Y'all got to settle down now. I'm trying to preach. 2 Chronicles chapter 20 tells a story we're familiar with. It's a story about a king named Jehoshaphat. And they were getting ready to go to battle. And they were all upset about the battle they were going to have to fight. And right while they were gathered in 2 Chronicles 20 and 14, 2 Chronicles 20, 14, then upon Jehazel, the son of Zechariah, came the Spirit of the Lord in the midst of the congregation. That's all I'm hoping for here tonight. that somewhere out there, Jehazel, where are you? The Spirit of the Lord came upon him in the midst of the congregation, and he said, hearken all of Judah, ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, thou King Jehoshaphat, thus saith the Lord unto you, be not afraid nor dismayed by this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God. He said, if you knew all I was fighting, I can't get, why don't you quit fighting? Quit fighting and let the Lord fight your battle. Tomorrow, go up against them. Next verse. Behold, they come by the cliff. You'll find them by the end of the brook before the wilderness of Jeruel. Next verse. You shall not need to fight in this battle. Set yourselves. Get in order. Stand still. See the salvation of the Lord. Fear not. Do not be dismayed. Go out against them, for the Lord will be with you. So you got financial troubles waiting back at the house. You got family problems waiting back at the house. You got all kinds of difficulties back at the house. Well, while you're at this house, I want to give you a word. Don't be afraid. Go home and go against them, for the Lord shall be with you. I'm prophesying into your spirit. He's going to fight for you. He's going to defend you. The battle's not yours, but the battle is God's. Somebody shout, yeah! Now here's what I like. They put the singers out in front of the battle. Seemed like you'd put your strongest warriors out there to lead the charge. But they got the musicians and the singers, and they said, you're going to lead us into battle. We're going to worship. And while we worship, God's going to go to war. Because we're not going to war. He told us the battle wasn't even ours to fight. He's going to fight for me. So here's what I learned from it. While I'm worshiping, God is warring. While I'm giving him glory, the Lord is setting ambushments against everything that is coming against me. So why don't you let a hallelujah out and let the Lord fight your battle. Let the Lord turn your situation around. Let the Lord set ambushments against your adversary and against your enemy. Woo! Somebody's gonna get free here tonight. Somebody's going to get loosed here tonight. Somebody's going to be delivered here tonight. Watch. I'm going to give you some stuff to shout about now. David went out to meet Goliath. And he said, the Lord that delivered me from the paw of the lion, and the Lord that delivered me from the paw of the bear, he's going to deliver me out of the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said to David, go, and the Lord be with you. David had a victorious mindset. David was a VIP. He was a victory in progress. Because David knew God had a habit of repeating himself. He knew God had a habit of giving victory. So David said, the God that brought me out before is going to bring me out again. The God that healed me before is going to heal me again. The God that helped me is the God that will help me. The God that delivered me is the God that will deliver me. The God that gave me peace is the God that will give me peace. The God that gave me joy is the God that will give me joy. What he did before, he's going to do again. He brought me out before, he'll bring me out again. He saved me before, he'll save me again. Can anybody know that what God's already done for you, he can do for you again? Has anybody here really been fighting a battle against something? Really been oppressed? You? Who else? Just wave at me. All right? Of those of you that are fighting a battle, have you ever fought a battle before that the Lord brought you out of? You ever been there before and the Lord brought you out? Well, I'm here to prophesy to you tonight. The God that did is the God that will. He's not the great I was. He's the great I am. Everything he ever was, he still is. Anything he ever did, he can still do. Anything he's ever been, he can still be to you today. I prophesy to you right now that God that brought you out is in the process of bringing you out right now. Would you give the Lord some high praise for a victory in progress? All right, we're just about 5 minutes from the altar call, or 4 minutes. These all jumped the gun. Hallelujah. That's the way it ought to be. Feel victory coming, why wait till it gets here? Get out there and meet it halfway. Sometimes you gotta meet your victory halfway. But I wanna just kinda dig it in a little deep to your soul before I release you here. Just before I finish, I want to make sure I get it past your brain and past your emotion, and I want to get this seed real deep down in your spirit. I got to thinking about God and thinking about God in the context of victory. And I realized that God always speaks from a context of victory. He always speaks from the paradigm of victory. When he tells them in the book of Numbers chapter 13 to take the land, he says, go out, search the land of Canaan, which I give to the children of Israel. Of every tribe of their fathers, send you a man. He just says, go get the land, I've given it to you. Never mind, there's still enemies in that land. Giants are still there. God just said, go get it, I've given it to you. God's mind, it's already done. And it occurred to me that God is not acquainted with defeat. Never lost a battle, never come up short, never empty. He just is not acquainted with defeat. So he always speaks from a context of victory. But here's where I want it to sink down deep into our souls. Although he was never acquainted with defeat, he was acquainted with grief. And he was acquainted with sorrow. And he was acquainted with suffering. And he was acquainted with pain. And he was acquainted with betrayal. And he was acquainted even with death. He was acquainted with rejection. He experienced grief and sorrow and suffering and pain and rejection and even death. He's just never experienced defeat. Because I've come to tell you tonight that sorrow is not the same as defeat. And suffering is not the same as defeat. And going through a valley does not mean I'm defeated. And just because I'm hurting doesn't mean I'm defeated. Because yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Because thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Hurting is not the same as defeat. Suffering is not the same as defeat. You can say, I'm going through this, but I'm not going to be defeated. And I'll leave you with this, and I'm going to let you be relieved. But we've got a little plaque in our motorhome that has been such a blessing to me through some hard seasons. It says, life is not about waiting on the storms to pass. It's about learning to dance in the rain. I think I'm just gonna dance in the rain here tonight. I'm gonna dance in the valley tonight. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemy. Why don't you go home shouting, go home dancing? Why don't you go into your house and declare victory and say, devil, you may be all over this place, but if you're gonna hang around here. Woo! Now, obviously, all of these people have decided they're gonna get me some of this. So I wonder, anybody out there, in case you was just being polite and waiting on the invitation, you was just being polite and waiting on the proper decorum of the moment. Preacher hadn't said come yet. So here it is. If you want some of this, if you want a little victory in your heart, if you want to dance in the storm, dance in the rain, get the lily of the valley. Come on. I invite you to the winner's circle. I invite you to VIP service here tonight. I invite you to experience some victory in the Lord Jesus Christ. Face your trials with victory. Face your suffering with victory. Face your sorrow with victory. When you get down here, would you lift both hands like a champion prize fighter and say, thanks be to God, which always causes me to triumph in every place. I speak victory into your Monday. I speak a miracle into your Monday. I speak some triumph into your Tuesday. I declare a winning Wednesday. I speak a testimony by Thursday. I declare a fabulous, fired up Friday. I speak a little Selah rest in the Holy Ghost on Saturday. And I prophesy a supernatural Sunday. Would you like to have a victory week? Somebody ought to shout and somebody ought to praise God, because he's going to put some victory in your heart while you're praising him here tonight. Both hands up, head turned back. Blessed be the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I receive victory. I receive healing. I receive blessing. I receive anointing. I receive deliverance. I receive the joy of the Lord. I receive the help that I need. I receive the help of the Lord. I receive the anointing of the Lord.
Who's next to shout? Who's next to dance in
me. Some are kind of lost in the spirit. We'll just have to let them go. If you're not worshiping in some other way, what do you say we just do one of them old-time victory marches? Now, victory march is easy. Don't have to do much. Just walk around and praise the Lord. Just walk and praise the Lord. We get it from the story where they walked around the walls of Jericho till the walls fell down. So we're going to start a little victory march here tonight. We'll go this way across the front, that way, across the back and down. If it's too far for you to go all the way around, take you a little shortcut down one of these aisles and get you a short circle. If you feel
Everything's gonna be alright.
We will
be alright.
Be alright.
Be alright.
Oh, don't hold on.
Don't hold on me.
Everything's gonna be alright.
Be alright.